And yeah, so I'm very excited to be at Stony Brook, and it's great to see audience filled. And I'm kind of, I mean, yeah, excited about that. But I also see in that a signature of importance and significance of machine learning in data science, in general, in sciences. And sciences and engineering, because that's what this talk will be about. Well, so I was introduced already, but what I wanted to tell you in addition to what I heard about my past, there are a few important things for me to kind of mention here. So after I came to Los Alamos, before that I was very focused on applied mathematics, theoretical physics of very specific setting, which is turbulence and kind of academic turbulence. But after coming to Los Alamos, I kind of started to spread, in both in terms of applications and also recognizing importance and significance more and more as I go of other computational and now data science disciplines. And I also realized that I need to have to ground it into applications, and one application was kind of original fluid mechanics, but energy systems became another application for me in recent years. And actually I gave a talk here in February at MAS, and there I focused primarily on energy systems, and I thought that I'll be talking, using as an example for how you can use data science and machine learning in sciences, I would start by telling you some story, which is fluid mechanics story. Right, but my path to this machine learning and data science was kind of logical for me, but now it's also, I think, very natural, not natural, it's basically, I believe, should be part of education of all incoming students, and those of us who are already old enough should basically, yeah, not only learn, but also learn how to use it. And I'm focusing in my recent, maybe 5, 7, 8 years on thinking a lot about methodology of how we would do it, and hopefully you'll see it in this talk. So now, and that's kind of schematic way for me to explain the title and what I actually will be talking about, put it in some simple coordinates. Of course, reality is much more complicated, but I mean, it's easy to explain. You need to start somewhere. And here you see that I basically contrast interpretability and tractability or efficiency. And well, it's all about how we use data to prediction. Well, in this particular case, I'll be talking primarily, I put physics and physics inform machine learning. It may be biology inform machine learning. Or linguistics. I heard today about linguistic inform machine learning. So in this regard, physics is a placeholder. Yeah, and in my case, it actually will be a turbulence of fluid mechanics. But now, it's probably easier to start here because that's where all young people want to go. So everybody now heard about deep learning. It's exciting not only because of job opportunities, but also because, well, it's really a gift which we are getting from Microsoft, Google, and other IT companies who invest heavily. And now we have things like TensorFlow or Keras, and it's relatively easy programming which we can do, and we can pick up and use it. Of course, often not understanding what is under hood. And often we discover it through actually typically through young students, and we apply it in sciences. There are more and more examples of this type. I'll show you more or less one of those in my turbulence story. And question will be, what do we do next? And that's kind of, I'll hopefully explain to you what are options for this next, and that's where I want to end up, physics and machine learning. So efficiency is tremendous. So it's those, we can have, I don't know, millions of parameters, and those neural networks perform extremely well. What we are lacking is tractability, right? So we often, as a domain scientist, we don't know how to interpret those results. We can get very nice pictures, but I mean images or typical sequences, but what to do with them. And then we recall that, well, we have in physics a lot of what I would call physics-informed tuning. Well, and actually in fluid mechanics specifically, there are all these closure models, which I'll be briefly describing to you. So over there, we understand perfectly well what we are doing. We have these phenomenologies because we don't know all those parameters, but there are very few parameters. And we intentionally design our closure model so that there will be not a lot, because in the past we didn't know what to do with many parameters. And well, we should have ground truth, and in context of what I'll be discussing, I'll be grounding myself to ground truth, which is coming from direct simulation, so DNS, well, how we are calling them in fluid mechanics, assuming that those are available, let's say, from supercomputer, and you basically want to accelerate codes. So that's roughly what this scheme is about. So I want to, well, I may start here, and I want to add tractability. I may start at physics-free machine learning or deep learning, and I want to add interpretability. Okay, so now what I plan doing today, I plan explaining you, giving you an example of how I go from this physics-free machine learning to physics-informed machine learning. Well, there is another path which I'll mention very briefly. But then in the rest of the talk, I'll focus on some toolbox which will be useful, I believe, in all those cases, because it will help us to bring this domain knowledge or structure into those problems. And so that's a link to what is coming in computer science and applied statistics and actually statistical physics under the name of graphical models. And it will be actually two sub-stories, one on learning, another on inference. And here I put in gray what I talked about last time, and it was actually example of energy systems, and more or less it fits in this general scheme of things, so it's like but another corner, so from domain-specific part getting to this physics-informed part. I'll not be talking about that today. Okay, so now concretely in the context of turbulence, we have this, well, nice, catchy abbreviation, MELT, machine learning for turbulence, and focus here would be on acceleration of scientific computations, preserving relevant physics, and with sufficient, doing it with sufficient accuracy. Acceleration is important. So now, well, I already told you about this gift which IT industry gave us, and I already hinted that it's very scalable, tractable, but interpretation may be problematic. And often, well, practically always, it's physics or equation free. So then, phenomenologies I also mentioned. So those are two ingredients or two corners. Phenomenology, well, it's acceleration. We have closure, much faster computation than this ground truth, which takes, I mean, supercomputer to run. But it's actually very difficult to tune. It's not automatic and it's not tractable in overall. So we are often doing it by hand. So now, and in the context of, well, I'm at Los Alamos, and hydro closure accelerations occupy a lot of people at Los Alamos. And, well, the results are certainly in billions, and if you'll contribute at least a little portion into towards that goal, so that's great. And, yeah, so there is this project with this title, under this title at Los Alamos. And that's, I mean, it didn't start even. Yet, so, well, more or less what I'm telling you is more like proposals or first results. So now putting it, well, it's the same things which I showed before in the corner, but now a little bit more of kind of bells and whistles. So this physics-free machine learning, well, neural networks are probably most famous example, equation-free, many parameters. And it's trained automatically, right? Trains means optimization. And, well, another corner, and it's, of course, very schematic, so maybe fluid mechanics, PDEs, so Navistocks, etc. And then you basically separate variables. So that's on a kind of domain-specific domain, on physics domain. You take degrees of freedom which are large scale and small scales, and you construct what is phenomenologically guess what is large scale, what we call subgrid models, characterizing large scale models. And of course, it has a long prehistory, but it was, well, and at Los Alamos, it started from Harlowens, probably many other places too. And Jim, of course, also contributed. So quite a, well, it's a very significant effort which is going on, but this is certainly on the tuning side. You need to, basically, you adjust those parameters, you run simulations, and then you do some kind of comparison, either with DNS, direct numerical simulation and experiment, and then more or less you come back. You tune it, you keep tuning, you cannot tune, phase space is very large of parameters, you cannot explore it in full, so you limit to very few degrees of freedom. And when situation change, boundary condition or something else, you start anew. And yes, I want to basically move in this nice sweet spot where I take advantage of both. Okay, so now, okay, when you think about how you would approach it, and as I mentioned, you can go from this physics-informed tuning part, or you can go from this physics-free machine learning part, or deep learning part. So let me, I'll be mainly illustrating it on, well, in those pictures which are illustrating this path, and that's what I'll be talking about. So, and importantly, of course, you need to, well, probably I'm jumping ahead of myself. You'll see that most important domain-specific input at this stage is through diagnostics, basically figuring out what is a criterion for comparison. But let's walk a little bit slow. Let's slow down and try to understand it. And here I'll be talking about what we did with Ryan and Peter and Andrei. And Ryan is at NREL. Basically, well, Ryan is a representative of new generation of, well, his fluid mechanics trained, and he understands very well what is, I mean, both on the theory and simulation side, but he's also was curious about deep learning, and he picked a particular deep learning scheme, and that was GAN, Generative Adversarial Network, and more or less that was the beginning of a discussion. And logic is that, well, if we can train to recognize cats, well, from not cats, we can probably use it in some way for at least generating and playing with images of turbulence. Well, and cats is probably not the best example because that's more like supervised learning. Here we are in the world. GANs is a one version of unsupervised machine learning, which basically you are given set of samples and you need to present statistics which is most consistent with this set of input images. And if you will be able to do it, particular test of how you good or not you are is your ability to generate samples. So that's more or less one most important aspect of unsupervised learning. And GAN, it doesn't need to be GAN. And actually, we are playing with various other schemes. Well, he just liked it because of a kind of game theoretic nature. And it certainly is very cool and very, very efficient. You can have really millions of parameters in GANs. Okay, so that was starting point, and then you need to have data as a ground truth, those input samples. And what we did, again, a very simple thing, and there are, I don't know, how many decades of history in turbulence studies and fluid mechanics studies, we have now already databases from where we can take images in different situations, and the simplest possible situation is a homogeneous isotropic turbulence. It's still, I mean, it's simple in comparison with other problems which are of interest, for example, at Los Alamos, but it is multi-scale is difficult enough in terms of physics behind. We don't understand. So theory-wise, there is no such thing as a theory of turbulence. And here, this question of acceleration of course is very well defined. So there are those samples. We pick them from John Hopkins database, and we play with them. And three components of velocity, and you don't take into account anything about Navier-Stokes or kind of physics or mathematics behind. right? So you have those three components and you have a snapshot. And you don't, you do even more crude thing. You basically assume that you don't pay attention to dynamics, you take those snapshots as independent, statistical independent snapshots. And what you want to be able to reproduce, to generate samples which will be alike those which are in the training set. That's what you're doing. And well, there are some characteristics of what are parameters of this data set. And now here are, results. And that is for this specific resolution. So this is ground truth, our DNS. So what we put in, and this is what we had out on output. And you can do it, I mean, there are many samples, and you can generate many training samples, and you can generate as many or even more synthetic samples. And you can do it, well, just for the purpose of visualization, with three components of velocity differently, and each of these little piece is an image. Synthetic image which you generate. And now, is it end of the story? And that's actually a very, very typical question, I guess. I'm sure there are people in the audience who basically went through this exercise and their specific, it may be not turbulence, maybe some other settings. And then I'm sure you were asking this question, which we've been asking. Well, I was celebrating, so those images, you may say, they look alike. Or you can start discussing details, but it will not be quantitative. You want to quantify it, right? And that's more or less what I'll illustrate how to do it and what I'm calling diagnostic. And this is where a first place where in this path, expertise, domain expertise will be coming into, right? And here there is a list of tests, and those of you who are in the fluid mechanics turbulence side probably know exactly what I mean. There are different tests I'll show you and briefly explain what are those tests, but we basically didn't put any of those. Well, those are specific. There are a few things behind this list. So first of all, there is a prehistory in the turbulence of fluid mechanics community. People attempted to derive series and attempted to do these closures. So there were a lot of efforts, and variables, proper variables were chosen, and proper characteristics were chosen. What is an important characteristic to look at? For example, Kolmogorov energy spectra. Or what we call intermittency, so the, well, probability distribution and tail of distributions of velocity gradient. What we call structure functions. And there are actually those five, which we identify as probably most important, going from as simplest to more complicated. And when we asked this question, we actually didn't know if it will be celebration or not. And let's start from spectra. So what is black is training data. What is blue is more or less synthetic data. And from all practical purposes, it's probably closer to celebration than to saying that it's actually not really doing proper. You in particular, in the spectrum, not only you see slope, but you see where it starts and how, there is a way to extract from the slope what is called integral scale where energy in turbulence sits. And of course it changes with the, situation with the smaller slices and larger slices, but by and large, it's pretty good. So it matches training spectra well in integral large scale, length scale. You already start to notice some deviation on the smaller scales. That's already indication that something not everywhere is good. So then, there is this object, which is actually testing smaller scales, which is velocity gradient. Velocity gradient, from a point of view of this energy spectra, is basically testing, this is a K vector, and this is energy contained in the K vector. And dashed line is actually a famous Kolmogorov prediction, which is actually not necessarily true. So there is, we know that there are some corrections. So now, velocity gradient is object which basically should pick this part, which is a largest K, smallest scale. So let's see. And here indeed, you observe that your ground truth, which is DNS for us, has much more extended tails. So with your, what do we do to get this blue? We generate synthetic samples with this gun, and then we analyze statistics, so we literally compute velocity gradient, and we average it over. And yes, so here there is already some mismatch. you get two objects which is supposedly also about higher order moments, which is what is called structure functions. But these objects, it's about deviation from Kolmogorov. It's about what we call intermittency and non-Gaussianity, but it's testing scales which are not the smallest. It's testing scales which are a little bit larger. Actually, not a little bit. Well, it's you should understand it as a function of scale. And this is exponent which you extract assuming scaling. And here, you again ready to celebrate because your GANs, which is your synthetic data and ground truth, are pretty close. And by the way, they're also pretty close to what is called Kolmogorov 62, which is a reasonable phenomenology prediction for that. Okay. So going on. So you basically, point is that you start moving from one from relatively simple objects to more complicated objects, and of course it will be dependent on your domain specific knowledge and your focus. Well, here illustration is on what we call in fluid mechanics velocity. Well, this velocity gradient which I showed you before, so velocity is a vector, right? And velocity gradient is a tensor, and you can take not only one component which I showed you before, this dv dx, but you analyze it, can analyze it as a tensor. So there is symmetric part, antisymmetric part, and you can start exploring this more richer structures and richer make a richer comparison. But before that, there's actually another test, right? I didn't tell. So my what I took from John Hopkins was for incompressible homogeneous turbulence. Incompressibility means a certain constraints on velocity, and I didn't put it in this training set, so it was not explicitly enforced. So I can check it too. So it's basically divergence of velocity. Well, we are getting some very small number, relatively small number, but still not zero, and that's also another test. Well, that's the last comparison along these lines, which I show, and not going into details, it probably will be of interest for experts. And for me, it's also deja vu because I was busy doing that when I was in transition from Princeton to Los Alamos. So basically, this velocity gradient and all this stress and strain and vorticity, well, alignment of eigenvalues of stress and vorticity or disalignment, basically will tell you about structures which are formed in turbulence. So you may have a pancake, right? So it basically kind of flows go this way and then spreads into two other directions, or you might get a filament, and it's also vorticity may be elongated in a different way. So basically, there is these special variables which you can extract from this velocity gradient, which are called invariants, and you can analyze your data, and you can draw in two variables either lines of probability distribution function, because that's all about statistics. And there is a certain anisotropy, which basically tells you which objects, is a pancakes or filaments dominate a certain part of the flow. And here you also observe qualitative consistency in the first place, but then you have much less anisotropy represented when you go, for that matter, intermittency, when you go to smaller scales. In synthetic data. So those of you who are interested in details, please ask after talk, and that's certainly not for general audience. Okay. So now, conclusions from this part. What did we learn? We learned to create unique velocity samples. Good, right? But we also start to learn about approaches to test it, and we develop, specific for this application, diagnostics, and we made some conclusions out of that. So small scales are not well represented, and there are some troubles with this tails of distribution. So the synthetic data and generated in a blind way certainly misrepresents those two aspects of real turbulence. And now you ask the next question, which we started to think about that, but we are not yet ready to make any definite conclusion. And so that's more like a proposal of what we are doing or plan to do. In view of this small scale, large scale, we took velocity and we basically consider images of velocity, but we can also consider gradient of velocity as image, right? Of course, there'll be more components, not three, but nine. Then we can do training on this set. Just that simple change, in fact, improves some of these characteristics. And I'm not showing it, but that's confirmed. And then here I didn't discuss dynamics, right? So my learning was based on edges. But in reality, turbulence, it's a map, right? From one configuration to another, I have a flow. And there are various methods, and some of them are mentioned here. So recurrent neural network, LSTM, so again, one version of deep learning. LatNet, which is actually custom code developed by Oliver, who is actually a very young student, not even a graduate student. And so we are working on that, and basically asking now supervised learning question. Supervised because you now map from one image to another, and your map is basically a dynamic map. And you are trying to replace it by neural network. And we are coming up with richer diagnostics. So because we are starting to go into dynamics, you need to formulate dynamic tests, and there are certain it's actually opportunity. General lesson is turbulence is difficult. There were many theories in the course of 100 years or maybe at least 80 years, they were all many of them were forgotten because there was no way to check. So now we can not only check those theories. We can also allow much broader class of assumptions. And that's a great opportunity. In particular, we can start enforcing or checking those assumptions in the setting. And then, so that's basically, I started to tell you, so this is what we did already, right? So diagnostics, and we just move. We didn't really move from here to there. We start to move. To move, we basically going into various approaches, various changes. And what I mentioned so far is not really improvement of this particular deep learning scheme, but more like changing input characteristics or changing setting. But I also can try to dive into this deep learning structure. How do I do it? The simplest thing possible is, so there is certain characteristics which is misrepresented. For example, the small scales of the statistics of tails of distribution. I can enforce it in the process of learning. And it's actually relatively easy to do within this gift which we got from IT industry, TensorFlow, for example. You literally correct objective. You add to your your objective, training means optimization, right? And there are, behind training, there is optimization procedure. And there is so-called loss function. You really augment loss function with these additional constraints. Well, you can modify a class of neural networks. Well, and actually, we are also going along this path. In original version of what I was describing to you, Ryan didn't use anything like convolution. Convolution is basically translational invariance. Well, turbulence homogeneous isotropic is perfectly translational invariant. So you can reduce number of degrees of freedom in your training. Well, moreover, there are other symmetries. There is a rotational invariance, which is actually also already implemented in the core TensorFlow routines. Well, there are other things which are not implemented, but which are very specific for turbulence. For example, Galilean invariance. So this is already where our students and our postdocs start to become, that's where experience, both on the TensorFlow side, or for that matter, on the deep learning side, and domain expertise, understanding of symmetries will start playing a role. So now that was about how we move from physics-free to physics-informed. And really one slide to illustrate another path. And it's really exciting project with this undergraduate student whom I already mentioned, Oliver Henning. And it's actually based on Oliver's own implementation of lattice Boltzmann in neural network. Think about that too. It's actually quite exciting. So, lattice Boltzmann is a specific scheme to close, to solve, you may think of it as a closure model for Navistocks. Now, what is it? It's a system of ODEs. If I If I formulate it as a map from one time frame to another time frame, it's a system of ODEs for these many particles, right? And I can slice it in steps in time. So I have this, let's say, particular computational code. It may be probably explicit, right, for better interpretation. And then I can think of those slices as a slices of neural network. Neural network is very specific, as opposed to normal neural network, where we have a lot of parameters. Here, all these maps are very concrete, very fixed, up to those, tuning parameters which we put in, because the system ODEs contains parameters. It's a closure. So basically, we're exploring this type of ideas, and in particular, we start to train our very primitive closure models, this large ID simulation, with only one parameter, which we are optimizing, but using all the standard flow libraries. And well, it works reasonably well, at least for now, but that's only first and certainly not yet publishable test, so it will be more, but hopefully you see the point. And here, in doing that, I'm more or less moving from this. Well, Lattice Boltzmann is, of course, a very famous tool which is on that side, but combining, well, putting it in the neural network format and then optimizing parameters is basically a certain step in this direction. Okay, I'm actually not sure when did I start.
You started at 10 past, so I...
10 past, okay, so half an hour, I'm good, yeah. So, and all together is, yeah, talking, planning.
I'd say an hour, but including
okay, 50 minutes probably, yeah. Okay, good. Yeah, so I'm half hour in my talk, and now I'm ready for second part, and it will be quite a change, and it will be already not for fluid mechanics, or at least fluid mechanics will not be mentioned. It will be mentioned at the very end as this tool is certainly will be used in this project which I introduced you before, but now since I... Well, even in this explanation of map, which explicit system of ODEs represent an interpretation in terms of neural network, I can think of that as introducing structure, right? Because normally in neural networks there is really no structure. All those functions which you train, you either not constrain them at all or constrain in a very kind of primitive way. But in the future we'll get. That's one of the points I was making. So you'll get through physics or through biology or other disciplines, you'll get very concrete structures. And now the structures, how you represent it and what is the proper mathematics and proper statistics which will be behind. And that we expect to be working well both in physics-free and physics-rich environment. So now buzzword and keyword for me is the graphical models. And I'll be telling you two stories, one on inference and another on learning of graphical models. And in kind of the same spirit as the first part, so it will be main ideas, main results, not really diving into details, but I'll be delighted to discuss details offline if you have any questions. And here, I'm assuming that probably not everybody knows what graphical models are, so let me illustrate it in a very kind of primitive example, but proper for university environment, right? So we have this setting when there are two students, one professor and one postdoc. And and we are discussing attendance and we're taking samples, yes or no, student is present or not, this or that day. And we have, many days, and supposedly we assume that there is not much of correlations between the days in terms of time. And now we want to represent it. We want to introduce proper language. So attendance of student A or student B or postdoc give information about professor because they supposedly work for professor. But postdoc's attendance brings no more information about professor because, postdoc works with professors or students. Suppose this is the situation. And you express it through two lines here, linking professor and student, but not postdoc to professor. Okay? So postdoc interacts with professor with students. So then we also suppose the student A and postdoc, they work together, they share office. those two share work together, but those two share office. And well, here we have a graph, and this graph nodes are variables. Well, those three, four heroes and nodes are variables, and edges are dependencies. So it's a graph representation of their dependencies in what they're doing and how they come or not come to work. Actually, edges, in how I explain, also carry some weight depending on interaction strength and type. And let's say student A and postdoc, they work together, so they attract, correlation is strong. And postdoc and student B, they share office, so they really don't want to see each other much, so it's weak or anti-correlation. And it's also maybe, I mean, this language or this setting or graphical model is actually very flexible and adjustable. You really may think of it as a language because if something else comes in this case, let's say meetings, and it may be day with meetings or day without meetings, and let's say meetings are only for professors, so professor may be coming because of a meeting, right? And not because he or she wants to talk to students. So it's a flexible language. So that's, I mean, very simple example, conditional dependencies. So basically, these graphical models is a tool which represents, help us to understand and put in a quantitative way joint probability distribution describing those, well, five nodes or five, well, heroes, well, four heroes in one event. So now we can formalize it. And of course, I mean, depending on how you think of it, you can use different models, but this Ising model is quite popular, and in this context, it's even reasonable. So you basically introduce a joint probability distribution, and you assume that your variables, they're really binary. Sigmas are plus or minus one. Well, that's physics notation. In computer science, we use zero ones, but doesn't matter really. And off you go, right? So we have a representation of this joint probability distribution. And so what I'll now tell you, I'll tell you a story about this graphical model, is how we learn those graphical models. And Andrei, Sidhant, and Mark, they were postdocs with me at Los Alamos. Now they're all staff members at Los Alamos, and this is in two papers. And the latest one is a kind of more physics version, actually a lot of simulations in science. And the first one is more like with mass proofs at NIPS, major conference in machine learning. Okay, so now what do we do with this graphical model? In graphical model, I gave you a very simple example, but I brought this Ising model, so that's what I'll be talking about. I'll be talking about setting, which is, for example, graphical model, even though many of these things which I'll tell you are actually generalizable. So now I'll be setting a question and problem formulation which about, learning is always inverse to inference. So I'll be telling you about inference in a second. Well, not in a second, in 10 minutes. But now I'm talking about learning. So now it's a way to explain it in relation between the two. Is in terms of what I call two-room example. Imagine that there is one room over here where you have this model. And you can do, you know this probability distribution, and you can generate samples in principle. You can compute marginal probabilities. It's easy to say, it's difficult to do. And this is inference tasks. So generate samples or compute marginal probability. Marginal probability, what is that? I pick one particular, a student, and I'm asking what is the probability of a student to come at this day. I don't care about anybody else. So it's a marginal probability. Okay. So, but suppose I can do it. I can generate, compute marginal probabilities and generate samples. I'll challenge this statement that it's easy to do. It's not easy to do. But suppose I can do it in this room. And then what I'm doing, I'm passing to the next room information in form of a sample. I don't tell in the next room what is the graphical model behind. I assume full observability, which is actually very significant. If you don't have full observability, so there are some questions, and those are delicate. And the question which I'm asking here is, in this sense, inverse problem. So I'm trying to recognize what is this graph and what are strengths of this pairwise interaction in Ising model. Yeah, so in this regard, I'm solving inverse problem. Okay, so let's think about that. I already mentioned this direct problem, statistical inference, and again, it's marginal probability. I didn't tell you what partition function is, but it's actually a computation of normalization. When I have factorization of probability distribution, I'm yet to normalize it. And to normalize it, I need to sum over all possible configurations. That's actually quintessential difficulty, and that's the most difficult task in this inference problem. And it's what we call sharp P complete, if I use computer science terminology in terms of explaining complexity. So it's exponentially, it scales exponentially in the size of a system. So it's a difficult problem. And now I am asking about inverse problem, which is, inverse of difficult. Okay. If statistical inference direct problem is difficult, is learning inverse problem hard? And a traditional approach, which is based on what we call in statistics minimal sufficient statistics, it is hard if you make it based on that. So why? Because you basically start from the statement, which is applies in the case when you have infinite number of samples. You have infinite number of samples, and you ask, if I have infinite number of samples, I can reliably compute correlations between nodes. Let's say all pairwise relation. And we know, and that's actually very easy to prove theorem, that from all those correlations, you can reconstruct those strengths of interaction. So this inverse problem, in principle, is well-defined. But if you think of it as a computational task and complexity of this, to do this reconstruction, at each step you need to solve what is called maximum likelihood estimator problem, and it's absolutely not tractable. So it basically scales exponentially with the size of your system. So you would conclude that, nope, you can't do. Well, the story is that it's actually relatively easy. And we were not the first to understand it, but we were the first to actually present a practical algorithm for doing that. And this algorithm, I'll explain you, it's actually very simple and intuitive. So there is not very old prehistory, and probably most significant. So it was started by Martin Van Wright from Berkeley. So all those folks are mainly on computer science side. Well, us too in this regard. And first it was, so I probably should explain what I am showing here. So there are two characteristics which are significant. So one is, I already mentioned, this conundrum of having finite number of samples. How many samples do you need to reconstruct reliably, right? So that's the first question you ask. And that answer you get is stated in terms of the sample complexity. And you should pay attention to this logarithm. So it's basically, statement is that to reconstruct, to solve this problem, you need efforts which are not only exponential, not only algebraic, very, very nicely scaled, logarithmically. So basically, very minimalistic setting will be sufficient. And the second question you ask is about what efforts. Because there will be algorithm, and this algorithm, as you'll see, is actually some kind of optimization algorithm. And what is the complexity of this algorithm? And by the way, in our case, this algorithm is also very tractable. So it's actually convex optimization which is behind, and it's tractable. It's not logarithmic, it's n force, but still it's not exponential. Well, there are, of course, there are some delicate issues related to degree in this graph. So it's actually this, even the best you can possibly do scales exponentially with the degree. Degree is how many neighbors do you have around your node. And it scales exponentially, but nothing you can do about that. So it's actually more or less what those guys prove in this paper. So it's exponential. And we basically get to the best you can do. So let me maybe skip this slide, and let me give you main idea behind algorithm which we suggested. And this algorithm, it's useful because it illustrates how, if you wish, That's other ground, how sciences, or in this case maybe physical statistics, statistical physics, helps to create, to find good algorithms. So think about the following setting, and it's just for your, I mean, for interpretation. You have a particle which you just force to stay at this position, and then there is another particle, and this other particle is either rotating around this particle or, well, in this case it is rotating, and you want to learn to figure out what is the strength of interaction, what is the force which attracts those two particles together. What would you do? And suppose you can do experiment. Well, normally what we would do, we would apply an opposite force. Experiment in this case, you apply opposite force and you tune it, I mean you change it, and this is your training or optimization, and when it will compensate exactly this attraction, and it will be on the borderline between attraction and repulsion, you'll see particle free, and it will basically go away. So that's a kind of on a high level idea, but let me now put it in a statistical context, because we are talking about statistics in here. So imagine that the strength interaction between two of those particles, so let me call them spins, using some physics terminology, spin systems or magnetic systems. So five is a rather strong interaction, so it's attractive interaction, what in physics is called ferromagnetic. So now, and those are samples which you generate in this one room, and variables are attracted. So more or less, attraction in this case means that samples are almost perfectly aligned, almost the same. Well, in this four sample generated, sooner or later I'll get misalignment, but that will be very rare. So probably plus, minus, minus. Well, if your strength of interaction is zero, so you apply this force, you compensate for this five, then it will be all over, right? So those, what you observe at one node and at another node will be statistically independent. That's basically an idea. So let's see how we use it. So now I have this distribution function which I'm trying to learn. I actually don't know the J, but for purpose of Gedanken experiment, let me assume I know it. And then more or less what I'm trying to do, I'm trying to modify my probability distribution. And I'm modifying it by adding this, I pick a particular node and I add this pairwise interaction between this node and a potential neighbors. If all, everybody potential neighbors, I need to add, and that's how degree enters. I need to add all of them. Okay? So it's good, and basically, if I'll be able to tune, and if theta will compensate this all strengths, well, I basically want to tune all those thetas with the idea to compensate all respective j's. And if I'll succeed, then I'll get all those pairwise interactions kind of decoupled. So it shows itself in the observation that if I'll be computing this pairwise interaction, of course, average over the statistics, then I should get zero. Well, trouble is, of course, I don't know the J. But remarkable thing is that, well, all this is a priori, but of course, I can formulate it as a posteriori. So now pay attention to the fact that what is difference? So difference is that this is a new statistics which I design, and this is my old statistics for which I can sample. I can have experiments, right? And what I'm getting as a result of this manipulation, going from a priori to a posteriori, is that object which I want to average over these statistics is actually observable. So theta is, I can change it, and I don't have J entering in here. So more or less, that's what I want to do. I want to force this correlation by tuning theta to become zero. So now, remarkably, so main lesson is a posteriori is good, and I can estimate empirically from samples. So now, remarkably, this getting zeros for correlation function, I can state as optimization. And this is optimization which is convex, so it's this type of observable, which I need to compute. And here I wrote it as I have infinitely many samples, but of course it will be finite sample estimate. And more or less I need to do this, use my favorite optimization engine and go to the minimum. Okay, It's actually, this story is related to something which is known under the name of disorder parameter and loop constraints in statistical mechanics or mathematical physics, but I put it under RAC. So now, reformulated in terms of samples, this is optimization which you are doing. So basically, those sigmas, k runs from 1 to m. M is the number of measurements. This is objects which you compute. Well, there are some delicate things about how you want to regularize it, but it's all about optimizing this function with respect to theta, and this is convex optimization for any finite number of samples. And there are various tests we went through, and tests, well, this answers in terms of complexity of computation and complexity of sampling complexity. We basically test all of those, so in interest of time, I'm not describing it now. But we went through all this test, and it is in the papers. And we, of course, experimented with various systems. So in this case, it's Erdős-Rényi fully connected graph, 25 nodes. This is basically lattice, or torus, rather, n by n, square root by square root variables, or spins. It's another example for some of those tests. It's basically some synthetic graphs which we design ourselves. Okay, actually, well, here there is an interesting side remark, which is first when I got that when we got it, I was very surprised, but then thinking about it helped to clarify it. In normal situation for inference for direct problem. So now imagine that I was mentioning this ferromagnetic, this five, you remember five, very strong interaction, right, situation. And what is in physics called disorder situation, when some of those pairwise interactions would be positive, some negative. From a point of view of inference, this ferromagnetic case where everybody, all interactions are attractive is very simple. It's much simpler than this disorder case. But from a point of view of learning, it's exactly opposite. And it's actually very intuitive, and then it's clear why. Because in a ferromagnetic case, I was showing you all samples I like. You need to have diversity in samples to be able to learn. From a point of view of learning, more complex problems are actually better because they give you diversity. That's an interesting lesson we learned through that. Okay, if you are interested in an application of this technique for validation of D-Wave quantum annealing machine, which Los Alamos actually bought, so there is some story about that. That's in summary what we've been discussing about graphical model learning. We designed local and consistent algorithm. And there are actually quite significant proofs. I was mentioning only one algorithm. We have another one which is more traditional, so-called pseudo-likelihood, and it's also performed reasonably well. Ours is still a little bit better, but only parametrically, not in terms of scaling. And there are extensions to other graphical models, in particular graphical models when the variables are not discrete but continuous. Gaussian first. Actually, in the context of this turbulence project, it will be super important to extend it to statistics which are non-Gaussian and looking for students to do it, or for that matter, to be involved in this type of project, which will combine both graphical model and fluid mechanics turbulence notion. So it's quite excited about that. Okay, so I have 7 minutes and I'll wrap up probably in 3 minutes. So we conclude based on this that learning is easy and inference is not. So now I'll tell you a little bit now in those 3 or 4 minutes about inference and just mention different approaches. And this is really bottleneck in all these structured machine learning problems. When we'll start putting structure, which are much more structured than current neural networks, so that's certainly what we'll face. And, I mentioned partition function, and partition function is basically this little normalization, little thing, which seems not important, but that actually if you'll be able to find a practical algorithm which scales with the size of the system not exponentially, well, better linearly, not algebraically, then you're winner. So now I mentioned that a sharp P. So basically you want to approximate it. And there are at least three different methods for approximation. And so it's Markov chain Monte Carlo, MCMC. So it's exact but slow. There is variational inference, which is basically replace this counting summation by some kind of optimization. And there is a long history behind that mean field, belief propagation, those words, if they're familiar for you, that's about that. And then there is a third one, which was considered to be least theoretical and least advantageous, but actually it appears to be, that's what we discovered recently, super good practically, because it actually terminates fast, and in practical context it's really a winner, which is approximate elimination. What is that? So when you start computing this sum, what you can do, you can sum, marginalize our variables one by one. At certain moment, well, you reduce number of variables, but as interaction, degree of interaction increases. And at certain moment, you basically run to an exponential complexity, you'll need to approximate and you need to approximate by low dimensional interactions. So it will be some approximation involved, and that's this approximate elimination. So now I probably jump over that. The only thing which I want to say is that this story is also quite interesting because it combines many disciplines, and this idea of elimination in particular, it's actually very closely related to what is now called tensor network renormalization, and it's actually related to renormalization group in mathematical physics and in theoretical physics. So enough of just a pointer for those of you who are interested. Okay, so now actually important thing which is I want to remember you to remember inference is a bottleneck, and inference, approximate inference, is what we need to focus on. So there are various approaches, and most promising, from my point of view, are hybrid approaches. Approaches which are, because you understand better structure, combine all those three approximate methods, and it's actually a very interesting discipline because it combines a lot of computer science, statistics, statistical physics theory, but also with the practical algorithm, and it is future of this neural network with structure. Okay, so, well, need students here too. and with that, I'm ready more or less to wrap up. And graphical model inference, that's actually a word which now we start to use. We didn't invent it. I think, well, who invented it? Probably Guy Bressler from MIT. Inference and learning, inference, is difficult, and inference is a bottleneck. Synthesis, combination of all those methods, is basically a way to go. These graphical models, they certainly generalize all those neural network ideas, and that's what is ahead of us in terms of putting deep learning on service for problems with structures like we have in sciences. And, well, all of that is a technical ingredient of this physics and for machine learning. And with that, I finished. That's, by the way, two conferences which we run in Santa Fe, and probably will be another one in 2 years, physics and for machine learning. And if you enter, there's actually material, quite a lot of examples of application of this type of ideas in different disciplines. So it's not only in physics, actually. Thank you.